For generations, the tale of a mythical beast has been whispered in pilots' lounges around the globe, one whose wrath has terrorized hundreds, if not thousands, of helpless pilots. He shows no mercy and cares not how many hours one has or doesn't have. He's rumored to be hiding in the bushes next to runways worldwide. And when you least expect it, bam, he gets you. He is the Ground Loop Monster.
I'm Trent Palmer. I fly drones for a living and bush planes for fun. Follow along as I journey off the beaten path of aviation.
All right, guys, in this video, we are talking about ground loops. I know what you're thinking, what? Another just talking video from Trent, no flying? Well, I know, believe me, I know. But I figure if you can't be up in the air flying, we could at least be here talking about flying. It's been said that there are two different types of tailwheel pilots in this world, those who have ground looped and those who will. I'm lucky to be one of the later ones. I have yet to ground loop, not for a lack of effort though. Man, I have been close so many times. Now, if you're sitting here wondering, what the hell is a ground loop, Trent? I've never heard of a ground loop. A ground loop is essentially what happens when the pilot has a loss of directional control on the ground in a tailwheel aircraft. Now, ground loops are unique to tailwheel or tail dragger or conventional gear aircraft. The reason being, their center of gravity sits behind the main gear, which is also the reason that the tail sits down versus falling on its nose. Versus a tri-gear that would have a nose wheel up here and the center of gravity would sit in front of the main gear. Now, since a conventional gear aircraft or tailwheel or tail dragger aircraft is gonna have the center of gravity or the mass of the weight behind the main gear, that mass right there is always gonna be pushing the main gear along. And since the main gear is fixed, it can't turn when the plane comes out of alignment a little bit and that weight wants to continue forward, or if we were looking from the top, the weight wants to go forward because that was the direction of the inertia, but the plane turns, the plane's gonna start going out, the weight's gonna push it forward, it's gonna end up causing the plane to spin around. A lot of times it ends up breaking the landing gear, hitting the wing, sometimes up on the nose. Any way you look at it, it's no good. Now, I know that's a little hard to grasp, so I went ahead and made this guy. I know it doesn't look like much, but what I did was I took a carbon fiber tube and set it up as a makeshift mini fuselage of an airplane with both tailwheel and tri-gear. The idea being that I could take something like this roll of gaff tape, set it in front of the main gear, and then this thing will be a tri-gear airplane. Once I move it behind the main gear, the tail will come down, and then it's effectively a tail dragger. And with the addition of this string, I can now set this thing on a treadmill, pull it along, and show you the instability that comes from moving the weight behind the main gear. Now you'll notice when set in a tri-gear or nose drag or nose wheel configuration, with the mass in front of the main gear, that the landing gear wants to naturally track straight. Now watch as we take the weight and move it to behind the main gear, how quickly the stability of the airframe is affected. Now another way to demonstrate this is using either a shopping cart or a luggage cart from your local commercial airport. Either of these are gonna have a set of wheels that are fixed and a set of wheels that swivel. When you push the cart forward with all the weight in front of the fixed wheels, the cart's gonna naturally wanna go relatively straight. If you turn it around with the weight pushing the fixed wheels, you'll notice that that thing's gonna start a turn and the weight's gonna wanna continue to push forward and spin that thing around. And there you have it, perfect example of a ground loop. Now in a tailwheel setup, there is a point with all airplanes that once they get a certain point out of straight, there's nothing you can do either with brake or rudder to try to bring that thing back. It's gonna come around on you. So the big question is, what causes it and how do we prevent it? Now the number one cause is just the pilot failing to maintain directional control of the aircraft. He didn't put in rudder inputs quick enough. There are a number of other factors that might contribute to a ground loop, such as crosswinds, side loading your airplane when you land, landing a little fast, low tire pressure, a stuck brake. There are a ton of different reasons or excuses pilots use for getting themselves into a ground loop. Now the biggest question is, what's the difference in flying a tailwheel versus a tri-gear? What do you have to change as a pilot and what do you have to do to avoid a ground loop? First and foremost, I am not an instructor, so don't take this as any formal instruction. I'm just a private pilot with a tailwheel and I've been lucky enough to not ground loop yet. Now what I can tell you though, after all my experience that I've gotten in my tailwheel airplane, is that a lot of this comes down to staying ahead of your aircraft. Now since a tailwheel aircraft is gonna inherently want to go anything but straight, you have to be ahead of it telling it to go straight, and it takes a lot more rudder input than you'd be used to with a standard tricycle gear airplane. Flying a tailwheel, I like to relate a lot of times to something like boxing. It's gonna be done with a whole bunch of little jabs on your rudder pedal. If you go and hold too long, you're probably gonna leave yourself open for a punch or a ground loop. And a lot of it's just about staying super active on your rudder pedals. If you watch any of my videos, you'll be able to see my rudder going crazy as I'm going on takeoff. And obviously as I'm going to a landing on my rollout. Now there's two key times that you're probably the most likely to have a ground loop. Obviously on takeoff and landing. Normally it happens on landing, kind of in the later phase of the rollout. The reason being your rudder becomes less and less effective as you have less air going over it. So you have to start putting in larger and larger inputs. Also a lot of different tailwheels will have a steering mechanism ran through springs that will actually physically turn the wheel on the tail. Now if you were to go and land on the main gear in say a wheel landing scenario, and roll out on the wheels and then let the tail down later, what you're gonna see is the rudder becomes less and less effective as you get slower, then you drop the tail and all of a sudden you have direct contact with the ground through the rudders and it becomes more touchy. Also, you feed in the fact of accidentally using brakes, that'll get people in trouble as well. On the takeoff roll, it seems like normally when your tail comes up, because of the P factor from the tail coming up, the left turning tendency is gonna try to put you off the runway. I had this happen my first takeoff I ever attempted, and I'll say attempted, in my Kit Fox because my instructor had to take it over, and I still don't know how we didn't take out a runway light or wreck my plane on my first takeoff, just because that tail came up and boom, it went left. Now, I don't want to scare anyone away from being a tailwheel pilot. I honestly think that pretty much anyone can handle flying a tailwheel aircraft with the proper instruction and the right amount of time practicing. But I will say the learning curve is a little steeper. So if you're making the transition from tri-gear to tailwheel, don't be alarmed if it's a little bit harder and you feel a little beaten down at the start. It's natural. I remember going through my training and thinking to myself, is this something I can even handle? I don't know if I have this in me. But after a little bit, it sort of clicks and you start to understand, okay, I have this. I just have to do my best to catch things before they get too bad. And I have a theory that there are two phases of a tailwheel pilot as they progress into learning and being truly proficient in a tailwheel. The first would be the reactive phase. And that's just the first portion of when you're learning to fly a tailwheel. Basically, you wait for the plane to do something and then you react. You say, oh, it starts pulling one direction. I'm gonna hit the opposite rudder to fix that, yada, yada. Basically, you're chasing the airplane down the runway. It's the way a lot of people do it. The second phase is when I think it really truly clicks and the seat of the pants takes over and you're able to be an active pilot. You start telling the plane where to go instead of waiting for it to do something and trying to correct it. You'll then be leading things ahead of the aircraft before it starts going somewhere. You're telling it where to go. Yeah, and of course, even the most seasoned pilots, all it takes is a little lapse in concentration and it can bite you. I can't tell you how many times I've come close, and recently, one instance I can remember not long ago, landing on a dirt road with Kevin Quinn. It was a turning one with bumps, and I remember one of the bumps loading the plane and the tail wanted to come around on me, and I was full rudder, full brakes, and I just barely, by the hair on my chin, pulled that one back. And that was one of those that'll have you getting out thinking, okay, yep, I'm not invincible. All right, guys, I'm gonna wrap this one up here. If you're new to flying tailwheel airplanes, be aware of the ground loop monster. But in all honesty though, I figured this was a good time to chat about that subject since I'm still grounded. So, till the next one, guys, you know the drill. Like this video if you do, subscribe if you haven't. Come be my wingman. We'll see you guys on the next one. Peace.